Hello everyone, I'm Daniel Treffer, founder of MeltPrep. Many of you know how much effort is required to develop a new ASD formulation. Most stories that I hear from our clients have two things in common. First, materials are expensive, and second, quantities are limited. If you have ever used hot melt extrusion, you know that this combination has a low success rate, and you are well aware of the joy of cleaning and the unavoidable losses in dead volumes, as well as during startup and shutdown phase of this continuous process. I invented vacuum compression molding to simplify the processing requirements for ASD and implant formulations in the very early stages. We are all familiar with the drug development process map, starting with drug discovery, going down via several clinical stages to bring one product to the market. Take a look at the compounds in this table. There is a lot of work to do to get one successful product to the market. The materials are available in small quantities only and need to be tested to find suitable and safe actives to treat a certain disease. Conventional screening methods used so far have all their benefits, but also challenges. A big challenge is scalability between screening and manufacturing. Hot melt extrusion is the manufacturing method of choice for various reasons. But it was terrible for screening so far. Only lossy, miniaturized extrusion equipment was available, often a showstopper. Extrusion was excluded besides the manufacturing advantages down the road, as simply not enough material was available. My invention extends now the playground for scientists in the field. VCM fulfills all the listed requirements. With vacuum compression molding, one can prepare samples from a few milligrams, making it comparable to solvent casting material requirements while mimicking hot melt extrusion. This here is my invention, the VCM tool. The vacuum compression molding process transforms any thermoplastic powder into a solid specimen with defined dimensions, parallel surfaces, and no air or moisture inclusions. And the best of it, it works lossless. Put 1 gram of material in, and after typically less than 10 minutes of processing, you get a perfect 1 gram sample out. Let's look at the process map again. We can help to reduce cost and time efforts in the very early stages. And we hear from our customers that they have a higher success rate in bringing their developments through the early stages, as they can gain deeper insights into their formulations right in the beginning. Using larger VCM dimensions with samples up to 5 grams, it's also possible bridging towards pilot scale investigation, providing enough material for further downstreaming, such as tablet compaction. The platform that I've designed to make the VCM tools easy to use is called VCM Essentials. On the left-hand side is the heating unit, the vacuum unit is in the back, and the cooling unit is on the right-hand side. The VCM tools are manually placed on the first heating unit and then swapped to the cooling unit as they go through the processing steps. Let me show you in an illustrative video how it works. This is the heart of the VCM technology. A PTFE foil is rolled up to cover the lateral surface of the VCM chamber. A disc-shaped foil covers the bottom of the VCM chamber. It is lightweight and can be filled on an analytical scale directly. After filling, the opening is covered with another disc-shaped foil on top. The foil's arrangement allows the piston to go up and down. The volume of the chamber is adaptable and allows the piston to follow the material behavior during processing. After the VCM tool is connected to the vacuum unit, the air is drawn out and the powder is compacted. Subsequently, the VCM tool is placed on the hot plate to initiate the melting. The powdery material forms a homogeneous melt. As a rule of thumb, this takes about 5 minutes. Once completed, the VCM tool is transferred to the cooling unit to cool it down to ambient conditions. After cooling, it is taken apart
and the sample can be released with ease. The BTFE foils can be peeled off like stickers.
Here you can see the entire VCM essentials again. A typical VCM sample preparation takes less than 10 minutes. Heating is performed in some minutes and can go up to 300 degrees Celsius, making it suitable for most pharma applications. Cooling generally also takes only a few minutes. At the end of the operation, there is no tedious cleaning required, making the process time efficient and lossless. The idea of the VCM essentials is to provide a modular platform where you can process multiple dimensions. There are two different tools available, one to create disc-shaped samples and one for elongated bars. By only changing the disc insert, you can make disc-shaped samples with diameters between 25 millimeters and 0.3 millimeters. The same principle works for the PAR tool. Different inserts allow you to manufacture different rectangular sizes. One thing that I'm very proud of is the small scale development that we did. I kicked the VCM tool off with a 25 millimeter disc diameter in 2014. My former colleagues at the RCB were requesting smaller dimensions for their investigations. We reduced it down to 5 millimeter to make it suitable for DSC and later even to 2 millimeters in diameter. You can use those small dimensions for the screening of implants, for example. 1 to 50 milligrams are sufficient to produce a prototype of a subcutaneous implant. But we did not stop there. We recognized the need for even smaller tools with even lower material requirements. Let's imagine samples with a length to diameter ratio of 1 and 1 gram per cubic centimeter density as an educated guess for a polymer density. When we look at the 2 millimeter sample, we would only need about 5 or 6 milligrams for one sample. For a 1 millimeter sample, it's already less than 3 milligrams. 0.8 millimeter is only requiring less than a milligram. If this is still too much material for you, or if you are interested in designing an intraocular implant, one can use the smallest dimensions in our portfolio, 0.5 or 0.3 millimeters. You will reach down in the sub-milligram range. Do you like these flawless samples here on this rotating video? Each of them was produced in less than 10 minutes. Let me show you some of the leading applications. It all started with sample preparation for rheology during my PhD. My colleagues were interested in other analytics, DMA, solubility testing, dissolution testing, and much more. It soon turned out that our customers are much more creative in using our tools than we are. To understand the benefits of the VCM process, I think it's essential to talk about how an API is mixed into the carrier material. Unlike an extruder, VCM does not mix mechanically. With vacuum compression molding, you only compress and melt the material. To illustrate the mixing mechanism, we prepared the following examples. If one puts multicolored pellets in the VCM sample chamber and runs the VCM process, one will obtain a disc without any air inclusions, but you can see the phase boundaries between the individual pellets. There are no shear forces and no macroscopic mixing. How can we obtain a homogeneous result then? Let's recall the mass transfer basics that we have learned in school. There are two mechanisms: convection, also known as shear or mechanical mixing, and there is diffusion. Since we don't have mechanical mixing, we need to empower diffusion. And we can empower diffusion by using small particles. We used an orange color dye on HBMCS powder, mixed them together, and then used this as an illustrative example. As a result, a good fraction of the color trace already diffused inside the polymer disc, but there are still some agglomerates visible. That's why we need homogeneous powder mixture as a starting material. To improve homogeneity, we have to empower diffusion by reducing the length scale even further. The way how we usually recommend doing so is milling, preferably cryomilling. Reducing the particle size before processing via VCM will let you obtain an extrusion-like result, in many cases an amorphous transparent disc. Another option is solvent casting. We dissolve the mixture in a suitable solvent and let the solution evaporate. The remaining film from the petri dish will put it in the VCM tool. It is also shaped into a completely homogeneous disc that is extrusion-like and suitable for further investigations. Considering the mixing, I can also answer one of the most frequent questions that I receive. Are VCM samples comparable to hot melt extrusion? At the AAPS in 2019, Thomas Kipping from Merck Germany, also known as Millipore Sigma in the US, demonstrated exactly that. They compared analytical results from VCM samples to hot melt extrusion. And one part I would like to highlight from his study are the XRPD scans. If you compare the left graph with the right one, you barely see a difference. That means VCM is also yielding an extrusion-like result in terms of XRPD data. This is already indicating that it's of great help for formulation screening. Based on this initial data, Professor Repker's PhD student Gauri conducted a more comprehensive study. In this case, the model compound indomethacin was used to study if hot melt extrusion and VCM yield similar results. The slides show images of VCM samples with 8 mm diameter with some common carriers, including Partec MXP, the PVA material. The samples went through intensive characterization, showing comparable data to HME samples. I want to highlight the dissolution data. The VCM and extruded samples were milled and then subjected to dissolution. One can see significant difference between the carriers. One unique feature that I would like to point out here is the performance of Partec MXP. You can see a very high saturation level over a long period of time without recrystallization. You can also see an excellent agreement between VCM and HME. It proves VCM as a screening approach, requiring only 1 gram of material per formulation. The similarity factors also confirmed a similarity between HME and VCM. Their paper is open access and linked on the QR code on the slide if you want to read more about this. The dissolution data before was generated on milled material, but there is no need to mill them. You can work with the VCM samples directly. The nice thing is you will get a defined surface in the beginning. You think about this approach, this can be seen similar like intrinsic dissolution, because the tablets that you subject to dissolution always have the same surface area. To illustrate that, we came up with an example of 2 different carriers, one time Solo Plus, one time PBP with 10% phenofibrate loading. You can see the phenofibrate tablet on the right is dissolving super quickly, whereas on the other side, the tablet is still intact, just lying at the bottom and dissolving very slowly, swelling a bit and then slowly eroding. This is also an explanation for the difference in the dissolution profiles. With Solo Plus, you have the zero order release in this case. With PBP, you have the first order release, the fast one. And this is very nice to test the performance of a formulation. You can tailor the surface area to your specific requirements. Along the same lines, there was also a publication released just before Christmas about microscopic erosion time testing from Abbeam Germany. It uses a microscope and the VCM sample embedded together with dissolution media between 2 glass covers. Unlike the dissolution tester, they forced a 2-dimensional stationary dissolution that allowed them to track the erosion under a microscope. By preparing multiple samples with various API content, their setup reveals the dispersibility limit of a carrier API combination with minimum effort. Let's move on to the next example. Are you interested in working on multi-layer systems? VCM allows you to fuse multi-layers to one specimen. So you can prepare various layers in advance, one by one, and load them into the VCM chamber and process them in one another cycle to form a single specimen. You obtain a multi-layer sample with distinct layers and a sharp interface in between. One application for a multi-layer system is the contraceptive using an intravaginal ring. A group in Graz wanted to mimic the complex structure of the Nuba ring. The Nuba ring uses a drug-loaded core with a surrounded diffusion barrier to limit drug release. The final VCM sample was a sandwich of two 100 micrometer thin diffusion barriers, which filled a drug-loaded core. Then they covered the lateral surface with barrier glue, used optical coherence tomography to check for the interfaces and see if the diffusion barriers are uniform in thickness. Afterward, they subjected the sample and the co-extruded version to dissolution. In the dissolution curves, you see a good match of the VCM and the co-extruded samples. What does it mean? It is empowering the single researcher. One single scientist can perform the VCM process, making the samples in the first half of the day and has still time in the afternoon to focus on research. Whereas with the co-extrusion, one has to conduct quite some process development. We are talking about weeks and kilograms of material before a good prototype of a new formulation can be obtained. This is a huge advantage. But recent developments allow us to do even more. We can manufacture core sheath structures in less than an hour. This example shows a 2 mm implant with a length of 10 mm, which is entirely embedded in the sheath. The fusion of pre-manufactured samples is key to obtain sharp interfaces, as you can see here on this slide. Let's move on to another exciting example. This study was conducted by the group of Claire Strahan in Finland. The aim was to reduce the risk of surface nucleation of pure APIs. The starting point are 20 mm VCM discs out of 100% API. In this case, indomethacin at a height of 1.7 mm. Air humidity is causing stability issues. Untreated samples immediately showed surface recrystallization, but VCM samples allowed them to stabilize the API by applying a 1 micrometer thin coating onto the specimen. On the top of this table, you see some data from the uncoated tablet in comparison the coated tablet at the bottom. What you can tell from the images, the surface of the uncoated tablet starts to recrystallize on the very first day, while the coating increases the API stability significantly. Many completely different possibilities are enabled by our easy-to-use VCM technology. Like I mentioned earlier, you are always more creative to use it than we are, so I'm excited about what you are doing next. Let's take a look at the drug development process map again. I'm sure you can better understand how VCM can help in the first stages. For further stages, we have an additional product called ExtruVis. It is a helpful tool for scale-up and troubleshooting of continuous processes. It's a camera-based system allowing you investigations of residence time distributions, giving you insights into mixing and degradation. It can also help you to trace down content uniformity problems. How does it work? You apply a color tracer at the inlet and point the camera to the outlet. The supplied software uses the color response at the outlet to provide the analysis for you. You get a residence time distribution fully evaluated by a click of a button. Then you can compare and trace down the problems that you might see in the process development. I would be delighted to talk about your challenges and explore a way of overcoming them together. That's why I invite you to book a free video demo where I share some of my insights and prepare a sample with your material live. You can conveniently book it via our webpage meltprep.com/contact or contact me via my contact details shown here. I want to thank my team for their help during the preparation of this presentation and the recording. Thank you very much for your attention.